Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Glad to be here. Oh, we're actually starting late. I didn't realize it's 7:03, so we'll try to make up time. And I have James here with a full deck of cards in his hand, and I'm going to draw a card, and we'll start giving away some goodies.
It's a winner right there.
It sure is.
Oh, my goodness.
It's his wife, Stephanie. That's not fair. He kind of pushed this one out, like, take that one. No. You want to give your prize to opportunity to somebody else? Let's put hers aside then, and I'll draw a different one. The other Stephanie, we're looking for the... Look, I'm drawing this one, and that one wants to come with it, so I'm going to take them both, and we'll take the next one next. Okay. James Hall.
God wants us to get a present.
Do you want it? Do you want it? Okay. Ronaldo Escobar. We know, and you're saying no too? All right, boy. Does anybody want? Let's see what we get here. Giselle Estrada, there she is. Come up and choose your gift. One of these three, and then I'll have you choose the next card. All right. Check it, Giselle. Josie, she's in the, this is, I'll be with her tomorrow. She's actually, Josie is their daughter, and she's setting things up for me to speak at the chapel tomorrow. I'm excited about that. You want to choose one for her, or shall we go move on?
What's it?
Okay. Then, Mom, would you choose the next one?
Ah.
Gemma?
She's still not cleaning up.
Oh, she's a child
care. All right. Boy, we're striking out here. Let me see if I can choose one. A winner that's present.
Aaron
Smith? Is that what it says? Smiths? Aaron. There you are. Okay. Give you that one. So you get to choose one of these books and then choose our next winner too as well, please. All right. Hey, finally, he got it.
Two for one or just
like... Choose one.
No, he said he was
going to
get with her.
Yeah.
I spoke into existence.
If it's that difficult, take both. They're yours. And we'll draw one more name for us, please.
Amen.
I've given him two. Because he's been waiting so long. And we've had a couple people win twice anyway.
Juanita Ramirez.
Juanita, okay. Thank you, sir.
See, when you speak something into existence, it's gonna happen.
All righty. Thank you. He's got the ones that were drawn. All right. Well, I hope you folks have all had a good day. Are you thankful for the rain?
Yes.
You're welcome. I got my car washed the day before, and that's why it rained. But we do need it, I know. So, yeah, today I had a really nice day. I got to hang out with some of my favorite people in the world, the pastors of the San Antonio area. We had a meeting this morning with them, and then we were able to go to lunch together, and so we had a nice time. And tonight we're here to study again, the mark of the beast tonight. What is the mark of the beast? Who will receive it, and how can I be sure that I am sealed by God, instead of receiving the mark of the beast, we want to receive the seal of God. Shall we pray to begin?
Amen.
Father in heaven, this is serious stuff we're talking about. This is life and death matter, not just temporally, but eternally. This is for eternal life. And so we pray that as we study your word, you would be our teacher and make things abundantly clear to us. May your spirit have your way with us tonight. Give us clear minds and willing hearts. And bless us tonight as we study. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As I was driving here, I was chatting with my son, and he asked, you know, how's it going? And I told him what the topic was last night, where we identified that beast of Revelation, that mystery beast, and we identified it as what? The papacy. And we said that, you know, Roman Catholics aren't bad people, but the papacy is identified clearly in Scripture as a power which is opposed to doing things the way God intended. That was clear. I mean, if you were here last night, you know those 10 characteristics of that beast and then the 10 characteristics of the papacy, and we say, well, there's no question that what it's talking about here, right? And I said, tonight we're talking about the mark of the beast, and he said, Dad, you know, because he's reading through that book that you just got tonight, The Great Controversy. He said, Dad, even as a kid, you know, I remember hearing and knowing, growing up, hearing you teach, but I didn't know how serious the crimes of the papacy were against God's people until I've been reading The Great Controversy. When he says reading, he's listening. He has dyslexia, plus he has a long commute to work every morning, and so he listens. He had been listening to the Bible, and now he finished the Bible, and so he's listening to The Great Controversy. And then he says that I get to a certain point, Dad, when I know I'm at this part in the road, I turn it off, and then the rest of the way is my prayer time. So I'm really proud of him and his spiritual growth. But he commented on how much more he's understanding this idea of The Great Controversy. That's the title of the book. This cosmic conflict, this immense spiritual battle that is waging in the unseen world around us. There's a spiritual war going on. And your soul is at stake because Jesus died for you and he wants you for all eternity. But the enemy wants you to go down with him for all eternity. So these are important matters we're talking about. Mark of the beast. What did the prophet Daniel see happening on planet Earth at the end of time? In Daniel 12, 1, we read this. There shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation. Think about that. Does it make you fearful? It could. But let's not be fearful, because remember, when God's people faced very severe, fearful times and severe trials in the past, did he ever let them down? We can trust that God's going to see us through this, but it's still there. The warning is there. There's going to be a time of trouble like there's never, ever been before, ever. That's how serious this is. And I confess, even as a pastor and Christian for many years, there are times I think about when I read stuff like that, I think, oh man, it's going to be tough. And I'm tempted to be fearful. Are any of you? Am I alone in this? Or are you guys all super Christians? You never worry about the future. Because it's going to be serious. Maybe we just don't understand. But as I told you, I see things being put in place. I see societal shifts. I see political establishments. I see superpower, not just political superpowers, but superpower corporations who are in control of so much of what we do today. You know what I'm talking about. I don't have to name those corporations. And I see their ability to control and influence the lives of every person on this planet. And I know that they're not being run by godly people. And I know that Satan uses people just as he always had in the past. As my son said, man, Dad, the Roman Catholic leaders were devastating, doing horrible things to God's people. And I said, yes, but remember, it wasn't, they thought they were doing it for God, right, in his name, but who was really influencing everything that was going on? the enemy. Satan was doing that. And he will do it again. He will use all the powers that be and available to him. So a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation. We read that and it prompts us to consider how serious the times are, but it shouldn't incite us to be fearful. Remember, our God is able to deliver us from anything. And like those three Hebrew boys, shake the bed, make the bed, and to bed we go, right? Remember them? Some of you weren't here when I said that. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and we'd rather use their Hebrew names than their changed Babylonian names, right? So what were their Hebrew names? I'll give an A plus to anybody that can tell me their three Hebrew names. Azariah. Meshach was a Babylonian name. Mishael, which is like Michael, Mikhail, and Hananiah. Good. Got a few A pluses here. Okay, so did those guys fear? Well, maybe they did. It might have been scary for them, but did God come through for them? They said, "We will not bow down to your image. We will serve our God." You know, our God whom we serve, not just who we believe in, but whom we serve, will deliver us. He's able. And then they say, but even if he doesn't, because in his infinite wisdom, maybe he won't for some reason, we will not bow down to your image. And then they get thrown in and they're thinking, okay, you know, it looks like maybe God's not going to deliver us because nothing miraculous has happened thus far. They're actually taken up and thrown into the fire. This is in Daniel 3. We didn't actually look at it, but some of you may know the story. And then rather than having, so they get thrown into the fire, and what happens to the ones that throw them in the fire? They burned up. The fire was so hot and intense that it had been heated 7 times hotter. Probably they put tar in there and blew more air in with a huge bellows. And the flames leap out and even burn up the ones who took them up there. But they did not burn. What did happen in that fire? There was another, and Nebuchadnezzar said it was one that looked like the Son of God, right? He's in the midst with them, and the only thing that happened was the ropes that bound them burned up. Guys, I tell you, sometimes we need to go through trials, fiery trials, in order to be freed from the things that bind us. And also in order to be walking more closely with Jesus, because they were in that fire and Jesus was with them. And then guess what? The king had to call them out. You throw me in a fire, if I can get out, I'm going to get out. If it doesn't kill me right away, you know, you want to get out. They're just hanging out and having fellowship with Jesus in the fire. And when the king called them out, I imagine Jesus saying to them, well, he hadn't come as Jesus in the flesh yet, right? So he was Michael, the archangel. But I imagine him saying to them, guys, I'm proud of you. You're precious to me. Thank you for standing firm in this tough situation. And, well, I got to go now and you got to go. So hang in there. I don't know what Jesus said to them. But they went out and they were free. And not even their hair was singed. But that miracle would not have happened if they weren't in an awfully difficult situation. So we ought not fear challenges, trials, and difficult situations if we're following God. Because it's in those crises that he shows up and does something amazing. And all of the miracles we read in Scripture happen because God's people were in trouble somehow. Right? So that's not to be feared, a time of trouble, just to be aware that it's coming. Hey, there's a few people here. I just want to say this before I forget. I had a really cool experience yesterday just before we came to the meeting. I went to see a volleyball game. So girls, those of you who are on the team, awesome. They had a game. They won their first match, our first game, and then they lost the second one and came back and, like in overtime, won the third game and won the match. And so very proud of you girls. You did well. It was fun to watch and you played well. And so had to say that. All right, what is the consequence of receiving the mark of the beast? Revelation 13 in verses 16 and 17, it says, he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave. So everybody, it doesn't matter what level of society you're in or anything, everybody, he wants everybody to receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads, and that so that no one may buy or sell except one who has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. So the consequence, if you receive it, is you get to buy or sell, right? If you don't receive it, you are... Now, let me ask you a question. Have any of you ever been traveling, or even at home, and suddenly your credit card doesn't work because they suspect fraud or something like that? I mean, today we don't carry... I don't carry cash. Everything goes on the card because I want those airline miles, and then I pay it at the end of the month. So when that happens, and you don't have cash, you're kind of helpless. Have you ever been in that situation? You got to call them and say, hey, what's going on? Well, we suspect, can you verify this charge or that charge? And it happens to me when I travel, mostly, of course. And that just gives you a little kind of a taste of what it would be like to suddenly be, you know, you're far away from home, or even if you're close to home, and you need gas or whatever, and you can't get it. Or have you ever had your phone just quit working when you're lost and you can't, your GPS goes nuts or something like that? Don't tell me it's because I'm an Android user. Is it? Does it happen to you iPhone people too? I don't know. I'm a strange animal. I use Mac operating system on the computer, but I prefer Android phone. Actually, my favorite computer OS is Linux, but nobody uses that much. So, would it be very easy for anyone today, for powers today, to shut down your ability to buy or sell? Now, do you know that already, more than a year ago, President Biden signed into legislation everything that needs to be in place for a central bank and digital currency? You probably didn't read that in the newspaper or hear it on the evening news, but it's all there. It's all set up. And one day, your money in the bank may not be available to you. And you may not have as much as you know, in other countries that happened. You had $100,000 in the bank. Oh, sorry. Well, now you have $70,000 because the government took 30% of everybody's money in order to deal with the economic crisis we're facing. Whatever. The time will come when you and I are not in control of our own money. And we'll be told how we can spend it and what we can spend it on, or if we can even spend it. With a central bank and digital currency, somebody else decides how, when, and if you can spend your money, and on what. Oh, you could buy this junk food, and you can buy liquor and cigarettes, and you can buy, you know, some kind of scummy magazine or something. You can't buy a Bible. Can't buy great controversy. You can't buy organic food. You know, they can control everything. Or they can, already things are in place so that your card, credit card, debit card, whatever, will work within maybe a 3-mile radius of your home or 5-mile radius and no more. That's it. All the systems are in place, guys. It's a matter of just flipping the switch and making it happen. This is not far-fetched. And there are also a lot of people who say there's good reason to go cashless. Think of all the illegal things that are done with cash. Drugs, arms sales that are illegal, prostitution, you know, whatever. We could eliminate all those problems if we can eliminate cash. So it's coming. The image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. So that power is going to even pronounce a death sentence for people who don't go along. How many people will receive the mark of the beast? All who dwell on the earth. And remember we said in Revelation there's this theme or this language of earth dwellers, those who dwell on the earth, those are not God's people. Those are the worldly people. You see God's people and the earth dwellers. Those are the two classes in the book of Revelation. So these are all who dwell on the earth will worship him whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So this is going to be a global problem on a global scale where people are buying into a system or accepting a system forced upon them in order for them to just exist. If you tried to do this 4 or 5 generations ago, probably wouldn't have been as big an issue. Why is that? Not even considering technology. Why wouldn't this have been such a problem 4 or 5 generations ago? Because your great-great-grandparents pretty much were self-sufficient. And if they weren't, you know, they were doing whatever they needed to survive, and the neighbors down the street, and so communities all provided for each other, and they met their needs, and you could barter. You didn't have to worry about today. Kids actually think food comes from the grocery store. They don't know that you have to grow food, right? I think it's just at the grocery store. If any of you have ever lived in a place where, well, I guess maybe some of the weather situations here could cause this to happen, but I remember living in the north when there would be a monster snowstorm or something and trucks aren't running. Within 2 days, the shelves are empty. I've taken pictures. This is just because I wanted to prove the point. The turnaround, if those trucks are not coming in every night, we are out of food. That's how, I mean, the turnaround is like this. And the shelves are stocked every night. When you're sleeping, somebody's working in those stores stocking the shelves. But we are not self-sufficient. And we depend on infrastructure and systems. Most of us don't have, I had a friend who said, I don't want to be dependent on everybody else. And he left. He had a very successful business in Atlanta. He was a builder of very nice homes for very wealthy people. He said, I'm hanging it all up. He moved up to Idaho, northern Idaho, bought some property where nobody knew where he was. I mean, it was really out there. I went and visited him there. He had his own water source. He had timber, and he had tillable soil. Lived by heat and solar, by wood heat and solar. And I said, my friend, you are the freest man on this planet that I know. He owed nobody anything, and he wasn't dependent on anybody for food. I mean, he could still buy and sell, and he did, but if he had to, he could live on everything he had on his homestead. But most of us aren't in those situations, so you can imagine what kind of problem this will be if you're put in a situation where you must go along with the system in order to buy or sell. Just to live, you'll feel like, I have to do this, right? How many people were still answering this question? Revelation 7, verses 2 and 3 says, I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice. So now you have a comparison, the mark of the beast or the seal of the living God. He cried with a loud voice, saying, so this is, loud voice means what? God's trying to get your attention. Now you're not going to see an angel in the heavens screaming with a loud voice so that we'll all be like, oh, wow, yeah, I better listen. No, how does God speak? Angel means messenger. God's people who are studying his word, like you people are doing now, are going to have an understanding, and we're going to share with the world this important message. Do not, I'm reading the wrong verse. I was going somewhere else. So this is some other message. Do not harm the earth, the sea, or the trees till we have sealed the servants of our God on their foreheads. So that's something in the spiritual realm where God is saying, there's going to be a sealing of his people, and his angels are at work, right? I was thinking of the three angels' messages. Yeah. Where is the seal of God placed? Revelation 7, verse 3 says, till we have sealed the servants of our God on their foreheads. That could be also, the Greek word could be interpreted or translated in their foreheads. Let me ask you something. What goes on in that part of your brain right behind your forehead? Yeah. I'm hearing lots of right answers. Free will, decisions, spirituality, critical thinking, all of that happens right up here. Okay? So So that's important. God's seal happens where you exercise your ability to make choices as a free moral agent in God's universe. You're created with the ability to think and to choose and to know the difference between right and wrong. You don't live by instinct like an animal. God has made it possible for you to know the difference between right and wrong, between good and evil, and you can choose. And this is where God seals his people, which means God's people are thinking, learning, understanding, reasoning. And sealing, it's not like, I believe it's not like this. God doesn't just say one day, okay, bam, you're it, you're sealed. Being sealed with God's seal is kind of a spiritual growth process where you're daily growing and settling into truth. So that, you know, you can't flip a switch overnight. You can't just say, you know, I'll get ready at the last minute. Remember those five virgins that didn't prepare and didn't have oil? Could they go buy it? Too late. And the others said, we can't give it to you. We can't, you know, they have their own oil, but they can't give. I can't give somebody the moral character development that they need in order to stand with God in the last days. That's something they have to do in their preparation for those times. What does God write on the foreheads of those who receive his mark? Revelation 22:4 says, they shall see his face and his name shall be on their foreheads. Name represents character. Thank you. In the Bible. So we will have the character of God, not because we're such wonderful people like, hey, look at me. Aren't we great, us Christians? No, we'll have the character of God because God has been working miracles in our life in transforming our character. Because let's be honest, I don't know if you're anything like me, but if you are, you're a dirty, rotten scoundrel by nature, right? We are selfish individuals. If we lived by our way, our will, we'd never reflect the character of God. We are dependent on God to change us because we are all born sinners. We're all born with a selfish nature. But God does this miraculous thing whereby beholding him, we are changed. And we become more and more like him as we grow in our relationship with him, spending time with him, and he fills us with his Holy Spirit. That's the most beautiful miracle you'll ever witness. When you are changed, your heart is changed, when you see it happen in other people. If you've ever seen anybody's life turned around by Jesus, you know how beautiful that is, right? So his name or his character is now in their foreheads. We begin, by God's grace, we begin to think like Jesus because we allow him to live his life through us. Revelation 14:1 says, having his Father's name written on their foreheads. Name represents character. When Moses asked to see God, he says, you can't see me and live. But God did reveal his character to Moses. He said, you hide in this cleft of the rock when you pass by, or when I'll put my hand over you and I'll pass by, you know. But he declared his name when he passed by. And what did he say? And the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious. Notice the adjectives that God uses to describe himself. And notice what he starts with and what he progresses to. Merciful and gracious. Long-suffering, that means patient. And abounding in goodness and truth. That's our God. That's his character. Keeping mercy for thousands. Forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. Satan wants you to believe God is a harsh critic. He's an exacting tyrant. He's a difficult judge who's going to judge you, you know, with severity. And he says, no, I love to forgive because I love you. I'm longing to spend eternity with you. So forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, by no means, though, clearing the guilty. So there's this switch. God says, yes, that's who I am, all of that. But you ought to know also about God. He is just and fair, and the guilty will not be cleared unless they accept the salvation and they're forgiven because of the righteousness of Christ, right? But on your own, you're guilty. By no means clearing the guilty. Visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation. And we may read that and say, well, that's just not right, God. Why do these poor kids and grandchildren and great-grandchildren have to pay for the sins of their parents? How harsh are you? And you know, I had a church member in Maryland who was a neurologist and a pediatrician. He had two medical degrees. And when he was a missionary in Taiwan, he became interested in Eastern medicine. And he began to look at some of those options. He came back home and he started working for Walter Reed Army Navy Hospital. And they gave him their most difficult patients, people that they couldn't help with conventional medicine, traditional ways. They would say, Steve, you're a doctor, have a go at it. And he was able, with things like acupuncture, to heal and relieve pain for some of these vets who were suffering for years. His wife told me he never got more thank you letters ever from any patients in all of his practice in the other fields in all of his lifetime than he did in those last few years when he worked with the Eastern medicines at Army at Walter Reed. Anyway, he said, you know what recently we've discovered? He said, genetics are an interesting thing because a gene is passed on from parents to children, and the propensity to have that characteristic of whatever that gene is, let's say alcoholism. My grandfather was an alcoholic, left his wife, my grandmother, and the six children, my dad being one of them, at home, hungry while he was out at the bar dressed in a suit and tie buying rounds of shots for everybody, and they had nothing to eat. Finally, they left him and lived in a little smokehouse, converted a smokehouse to smoke meat into their house, and the six of them lived in that tiny place. I went and saw it. My dad showed me one time where he grew up. It was amazing. Anyway, that propensity for alcoholism was passed on to my father, and after my mom died, he began drinking heavily. And it was passed on to me. And I told you last night I would start, I think I told you sometime this week, that I would start my day with a couple shots of alcohol and a couple lines of Coke. And I drank every day, cigarette in one hand, beer in the other, all night long until the bar closed, and dragged myself out of bed in the morning to go to work. That was my life. So that alcoholism gene was a propensity that was switched on by my grandfather, switched on by my father, switched on by me. Thankfully, my son said, Dad, I know your history. I'm not going there. And my daughter. So guess what? Now they still have the propensity, but if they don't flip that switch on, if time should last, and by God's grace, I don't think it will, and we'll be out of here before this, as much as I'd love to be a grandfather, I was just talking to my son about this on the drive here, because he longs to be a dad. But he's not married, and there's a better order to do things in, right? So take it in order. And so if time should last, and they're not flipping the switch on, and their kids don't flip on the switch, and their kids don't, guess what? After the third or fourth generation, what they've now discovered is that the genetic propensity toward that trait, in this case we're talking about alcoholism, will not be there anymore. The genes can reset. So rather than reading this and saying, wow, God is harsh that he punishes people three or four generations down the line for the sins of their fathers, actually what he's saying is, and this is how Dr. Steve told me, you know, he said, now I read it and I interpret it differently, and I agree. He's saying, I'm going to limit the effects of sin. It can only go on for so many generations. They're not always going to have to pay forever, but everybody has the choice to overcome. Everybody can set the switch on or off in all of our genes. Do you see how important it is for you to make good choices in your life so that your children are set up for success too, and your grandchildren? All right, so God's character, his name represents his character, and it's a beautiful character. Who does God call us to worship in earth's final days? Revelation 14:7 says, worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and the springs of water. That is creation language. We looked at that before. It's calling us to worship the Creator, and the Sabbath is a memorial to creation, we noticed. Exodus 20, verse 11, "For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them." And remember I told you that half of the book of Revelation, at least half of it, is either a direct quote from the Old Testament or a very clear allusion to the Old Testament. So you cannot study the book of Revelation without looking back and understanding the connections to the Old Testament. The Bible is one book. Christians who throw out the Old Testament and say, "Oh, that's old Jewish code, we don't need that," they're missing the foundation and the keys that unlock the understanding of the New Testament. And remember that even though the New Testament is written in Greek, it's written by Hebrew thinkers. Even though they were using Greek as the language, their minds were Hebrew in their thought. So Hebrew ideas are conveyed with Greek language. And when you understand the Old Testament, you have a much better grasp of the New Testament. So the allusion there is clear. Worship the Creator. And the Sabbath is the memorial to the creation. Which part of God's law is the special sign of God's authority? Ezekiel 20:20, "Hallow my Sabbaths, and they will be a sign between me and you, that you may know that I am the Lord your God." And that's God's primary concern. I think I told you before, if you read through the book of Ezekiel, you're going to see over and over, "And they will know that I am God. They will know that I am the Lord." That's his concern. Everything he's doing, allowing them to go into captivity, it's always, "I want them to know that I am the Lord," because they've forgotten. My people have forgotten me. And not in Ezekiel, but he says, you know, the ox knows his master, but my people don't know their master. They don't know their God. Excuse me. Why is the Sabbath called the seal of God? Exodus 20, verse 11, "For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day." Ezekiel 20:20, "I also gave them my Sabbath to be a sign between them and me." I'm sorry, 20, verse 12. We read 20:20 before where it was called a sign, and here it is too, "that they might know that I am the Lord who sanctifies them." So the seal of God is the Sabbath, his sign, which shows you he's the one who's sanctifying you. So does that mean that I can earn my way to heaven by keeping the Sabbath? Sabbath is God's invitation to you to have a weekly date with him. I hope it's okay for me to share this, Pastor and Mrs. Pastor. Pastor Tuianatoa and Mrs. Tuianatoa had lunch with me yesterday. And I asked them, "What do you guys do to keep your marriage happy and healthy?" And they said, "We have a lot of date time. We spend time together on dates. We will do something special." And I said, "And the family?" And they're like, "Yeah, we do that with the girls too, with our daughters. We have a game night, or we do..." You see, spending time with people is how you keep happy, healthy relationships, right? So, God says, "I want a happy, healthy relationship with you." But that requires that we spend time together. Yes, you should spend time with your Lord every morning and every evening. You know, start your day with prayer and Bible study. End your day with prayer. Talk to him all through the day. Be in constant contact with him. Pardon, I'm not trying to advertise for an email marketing company. But just be in constant contact with the Lord. But he says, "You've got to work for a living, I know that. But guess what? You can do it in 6 days, and you can set aside that Sabbath day that I created, and you'll be fine. The world is not going to stop spinning if you quit working on one day a week." And so Sabbath is our reminder that we don't have to be in control of everything. We can just exhale, relax, put everything on pause and say, "God, you got this. You're in control." It's hard for us as pastors, right, Pastor Michael? But Sabbath is a day for us to gain spiritual rest and to just chill with God and with God's people. It's a day when we spend time together, because spending time together nourishes a relationship. And when you have a relationship with the one who is holy, guess what's happening to you? He's making you holy. Remember, we said it's God's presence that makes something holy. When he told Moses, take those sandals off your feet because you're standing on holy ground. The ground wasn't holy until God showed up. He's what made the ground holy, right? In the same way, what makes Sabbath holy, God pronounced it holy, his blessing upon it, but his presence, though he's always present with us, he made Sabbath especially a time of presence for him. So listen, very interesting. Did anybody see what happened recently in Mecca because of the weather patterns over there, and people were at the Muslims were worshiping at the blanking on the Kaaba, and these cockroaches just started emerging by the millions. Have you seen that? They had to flee. They were like, you know, climbing up on the people. They were fleeing out of there. But that's a holy, sacred space for them. You know, if a Muslim, at least once in their lifetime, they're supposed to make that Hajj, that pilgrimage to Mecca. And they pray toward Mecca. Other religions have sacred shrines in different places. You know, they have their holy places. Christianity doesn't have that. Oh, people have tried to make like the Tomb of the Holy Sepulchre and all these places holy. And it's amazing to go to the Bible lands and see places where, you know, it's pretty clearly established this is where something happened. But God never told us to make those places holy or reverence them in any special way. What did God make holy? He made time holy. There's no place on earth that God said this is holy. It used to be the sanctuary, tabernacle, the temple where his presence dwelt. But even then, it was possible for anybody, no matter where they were, they didn't have to go anywhere in order to enjoy God's presence and his blessing because Sabbath came to them. Sabbath comes to us. You want to read an interesting book about Sabbath? Abraham Heschel was a rabbi who wrote a very interesting book called A Palace in Time. And he talks about this concept that God, the king of the universe, made the Sabbath the queen of the universe, so to speak. That's how Jewish people often think of it. But it's a holy time instead of a holy place, and it's available and accessible to everybody. It comes to us. And that's why Jewish families, you'll see the mother of the home lighting the menorah and then welcoming the presence, like this, with these motions, the presence of the Sabbath coming, the Lord is coming. Along with the queen of the universe, the Sabbath, comes the king of the universe, the creator. So God says, I gave you the Sabbath so that you could know I'm the one who sanctifies you or makes you holy. Do you see how important Sabbath is to God? Should we take it lightly? Should we mess with it? God said, I bless this day. And it's a sign between me and my people. It's very sacred, very special. It's in the heart of the Ten Commandments. It's the fourth commandment, but when you read all of, you know, the last six are quite short. So it's kind of the middle, the heart of the Ten Commandments. The first four speak to our relationship with God. The last six speak about our relationship with each other. So vertical relationship, horizontal relationship. God's law covers it all. And the fourth commandment is the only one that begins with the word remember. God says it's important for you to remember the Sabbath. And Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments. So that includes the fourth commandment. So who is the beast who has his own mark of authority in Revelation? Revelation 13:12 says he exercises all the authority of the first beast in his presence. So we're talking about a second beast who, and a first beast, let's unpack it a little more, and causes the earth and those who dwell in it to worship the first beast. So this second beast wants everybody in the world to worship the first beast. Who is that first beast? We have a clue right here. Whose deadly wound was healed? What did we look at last night? What was the year? I'll give you more bonus points here tonight if somebody can tell me the year. What? 1798 was the year that General Berthier went down on Napoleon's mission because his first general 2 years before dilly-dallied around, didn't get the job done because prophecy was not yet fulfilled. It had to happen in 1798. So he sends Berthier, he captures the Pope, the Vatican is captured, and people said, that's it, it's over. The papacy is dead. But that deadly wound, that mortal wound, was healed, and all the world would wander after that beast. So here you go. That's the first beast. This second beast is exercising authority to point people back to do what the first beast wants. What is the number of the beast? Revelation 13, verse 18 says, let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast. So it's something we should be able to understand. For it is the number of a man, his number is 666. I recently went to a convention, a North American-wide convention in Florida, representing Texas Conference. And it was in Fort Myers, Florida, and it was at a very nice, they hosted it at a nice resort hotel, because there was a lot of people coming, it had to be a big place. And I checked in, and I got my room key, and looked at the number, it was 666. I even made a post about it on Facebook, because I thought it was so comical. I said, well, I wouldn't have chosen this room number, but the view is nice, viewing the ocean there. And I thought, it's interesting that I even commented about it, and the guy at the desk said, yeah, you'd think they would just like skip over that number or something, because most people wouldn't want a room 666, but, nothing weird happened. God was with me, you know, so it's not about that, of course. We're not superstitious, you know. In some European countries, they skip floor 13, because people are superstitious about 13. This is not something to be superstitious about, but there is something we should be able to figure out regarding 666. God's giving us some clues. So let me tell you something that some have... Wow. Can I just be like really transparent with you and say that in an effort to try to help the cause of truth, somebody once had the great idea, some Adventist guy, of making it very abundantly clear that this is a title for the Pope. It is a title that's applied to the Pope sometimes, okay? And this was back before we had the technology of Photoshop. Somebody kind of airbrushed onto the Pope's mitre, that big hat he wears, this title. When they were doing the presentation on prophecy, like in order to show, see, this is what the Pope, they were just trying to show, look, I put that title on there. They figured, you know, it'll make it abundantly clear. But then others have said, then they found out that that wasn't on the Pope's mitre, and they said, see, this isn't, you can't use this illustration. Whether it's on the cap or not doesn't matter to me. I think that guy did harm by trying to, you know, I'm going to go extra effort to help the cause. We ought not do that. But what we do know is it is a title that is sometimes ascribed to the Pope. So let's consider that title. You know that Roman letters, some of them have a numerical value attached to them. And so we call them Roman numerals, right? If you were going to write a 1, you would use the Roman letter I, right? And the next one is a 5. So to make 6, you go V, because that's 5, and I, right? And that's 6. You all understand Roman numerals. A lot of them don't know it anymore. We homeschooled, and the homeschool curriculum that we used actually made our kids learn Roman numerals, so it was kind of good. But and it made them learn to write cursive, too, which, you know, have you seen those Instagram memes for old people like me? That says that we could cripple an entire generation by writing cursive and everybody making every car standard shift, you know? So, all right. Vicarius Filii Dei is the title, and let's see what each of these letters equals numerically when we add them up. 5, 1, C is 100, like you can think century, 100. A doesn't have a numerical value, R, 0, I is 1 again. U is the same as a 5. A V, right? In Roman, you sometimes see old Roman writing and it has a V where you would expect a U. So that's 5. And then S is 0. Next one. So that adds up to 112. 0, 1, 50 for L. 1, 1, That adds up to 53. D is 500, the big one. Zero and another one. And that adds up to 501. Now, I'm going to give you three guesses to tell me what you think the total of the three across the bottom is, but the first two don't count, okay? How many of you need three guesses? Can you get it with one? If you're a real good mathematician, you've already done the math in your head, but you probably don't need to do the math because you can assume it is 666. Isn't that interesting? Coincidence? Maybe. You could say, well, I'm not buying it. It doesn't matter if I mean, this is, to me, this is just extra evidence. But what we looked at last night, remember, those 10 characteristics of the little horn power were so abundantly clear. Here's the little horn power, here's the papacy, all 10 characteristics match up. And we realize it's talking about the papacy. So here's another, just one more thing to add to the mix. The title Vicarius Filii Dei does add up to 666. Now, somebody could say, oh, you're stretching your, because I remember when I was in high school, Ronald Reagan was running for president, and people had figured out, they used to call him Ronald Reagans, his opponents, you know, and people had figured out that if you ascribe certain numbers to all of the letters in his name, it comes up to 666. So Ronald Reagan is the Antichrist. And I thought, ooh, wow, you know. I was too young to vote at the time. I was not quite 18 in high school. So it didn't affect me, a vote for me, but, you know, people were talking about that. But this is more serious, you know, rather than trying to make prophecy fit a contemporary thing. We know we've already looked at a power that matches what Scripture was pointing to, and this does agree with that. So what's the number of the beast? Revelation 13, 18. Again, we looked at it, calculated, it's 666. Where is the mark of the beast placed? He causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or their foreheads. Now, we already talked about the forehead being the seat of critical thinking, where you make your decisions and spirituality, and all happens behind the forehead here, right? What does the hand have to do with it? Yeah, your hand is since you said it, we might as well just talk about it. You're a good student. You understand this stuff. Hand represents what you do. As a matter of fact, it's quite interesting. In the Renaissance period, another, if you like to go into some cool, deep reading, I would recommend Francis Schaeffer, one of the most interesting, I think, one of the most interesting critical thinkers of modern times. He's no longer living, but kind of like a C.S. Lewis Christian philosopher. Francis Schaeffer was a philosopher and apologist, and he wrote a book called How Then Should We Live? And in there, he talks about this transitional shift that's happening in culture away from Christian values. And one of the things that he was talking about is in the Renaissance, suddenly people were understanding science, and they were beginning to understand more about the world around them, and then understanding, because, of course, the earliest scientists were all believers in a creator God, and therefore they believed he's a God of law and a God of order, therefore there's law and order in the universe, and therefore we can study it, and we can expect it to be constant. Science doesn't work if you don't have constant. If the principle of gravity is not always at work, then, you know, you can't do science, right? If the laws of math are not always consistent, you can't do math. So they began to understand that, but then when they began to understand it more, they started thinking we can control the world around us more. They felt more empowered, and there was this sudden age of enlightenment where humanism began to emerge as the new bright era where we're not so critically dependent on ancient religious ideas. French Revolution, of course, came out of that. But what you notice in the art of the Renaissance period is that paintings and statues had bigger hands that were not proportional. They weren't quite right. And that was a representation of this idea that we can do so much, make the hands bigger, because we do things with our hands. So the hand represents what you do, which seems to indicate that people who receive the mark of the beast maybe do it like, because they believe it, they get it in the forehead, Or maybe they do it because it's just convenient. They do it by what they do. Well, I don't care about all this stuff. I don't really believe that. But if I don't go along with this, I can't buy or sell, and I got to buy and sell to live. So that's indicated as getting on the hand. Not a literal mark. You're not going to see a stamp on someone's head or on their hand. This is symbolic language. Notice that the seal of God is never mentioned as being something that's available in the hand, because you cannot work or do anything in order to attain God's approval. It has to be that you accept it, the gift, you understand it, and you align your thinking with the God of the universe. So Carl Keating wrote a book on Catholicism and fundamentalism. You know what fundamentalism is? That's basically Christianity, which says you follow the Bible only, just the Bible, and you get back to the roots of Scripture. And so he says, well, fundamentalists meet for worship on Sunday. So they would be opposed to Catholicism because they're saying the Roman Catholic Church is too immersed in tradition, and we want to follow the Bible. So he's talking about the two groups. Fundamentalists meet for worship on Sunday, yet there is no evidence in the Bible that corporate worship was to be made on Sundays. So he's saying, as a Catholic, you can't prove it from the Bible that you ought to be worshiping on Sunday, and yet you claim to be fundamentalists. How do you explain that? He says the Jewish Sabbath, or day of rest, was, of course, Saturday. It was the Catholic Church that decided Sunday should be the day of worship for Christians in honor of the resurrection. And we talked about that before, too. The justification was, well, Jesus rose on Sunday, and so that was a convenient way to get former pagans who were used to worshiping on Sunday. The sun god was the chief god. That's why he got the first day of the week. And, well, let's all worship as Christians now on the first day of the week, because that's our convenient day that we're accustomed to, and we'll say it's because Jesus rose on Sunday. Also in Clericorum Institutione, my daughter would pronounce this better than I. She studied in Italy last year, and her Italian is actually very good. Book 2, chapter 46, it says this: moreover, the same Pope decreed that the rest of the Sabbath, that's not like what's left over, but the rest that we experience on the Sabbath, should be transferred rather to the Lord's Day, that's what they called Sunday, in order that on that day we should rest from worldly works for the praise of God. So he's saying, you used to rest, you know, the way that Sabbath was kept before, now we should transfer that and make it Sunday, the day that you rest and experience, and you use that day to praise God. Now, knowing what we've read about Sabbath already in Scripture and how important it is to God, and he says, it's my special sign between me and my people. I sanctified that day, and I will sanctify you on that day. It's a sign so you know I'm the one who sanctifies you. Should we be messing with it? Do we have the authority to take what God, the King of the universe, has made his day and say, well, thanks God, but we're going to do it over here. We're going to transfer what the blessing you put on it, we have the authority to take it and put it over here. Well, some say, yeah, that's what he's saying. We can do that. The church has that authority. In the commentary on Psalm 92, if you read it, it's a psalm for the Sabbath is what's in the subtitle of the psalm. Eusebius, who was an early bishop in Caesarea, says, and all things whatsoever that it was duty to do on the Sabbath, these we have transferred to the Lord's Day, we the church authorities. We've transferred them to the Lord's Day, that's Sunday, as more appropriately belonging to it, because it has precedence and is first in rank and more honorable than the Jewish Sabbath. Remember, Christians and Jews were beginning to do, they started together at the source, and the only difference between a Christian and the Jew in the early church was what? Is Jesus the Messiah or not? No, they were all worshiping on the Sabbath. They were all observing the same dietary laws, everything. The Christians were just Jews who believed that Jesus is the Messiah who was to come. And then they grew apart from each other over time. And they made distinct efforts to especially separate themselves from one another. We are not Jews. And the Jews are saying, we are not Christians. And some of them were persecuted at different times and different places. So if Jews are being persecuted, you really want to distinguish yourself that I'm not one of them. We worship on Sunday, not on Saturday or Sabbath. What does the papacy believe it has the power to do? Daniel 7:25, and shall intend to change times and law. So the papacy, that little horn power that we looked at and identified as the papacy last night, he thinks he has the power and the authority to change times and law. So let's look at the law and see what happens. This is an, I don't know, my slides are messed up and I don't have it indicated here, but if you read a catechism guide from the Roman Catholic Church, so a convert's guide to catechism. So this was published as a study book for people to prepare to commit to being Roman Catholics, right? This is what the law says in that guide. On the left, you have the Ten Commandments as the summary of it. It's not all there, of course. That's the way the Ten Commandments go, in the blue there. On the right, in the gold, you have the Catechism from the Roman Catholic Church. So number one is, you shall have no other gods before me. Number two, you shall not make for yourself a carved image. Look over to number two in the Catechism, and it's not there. They just removed the second commandment. Why would they do that? Have you been in a Catholic church? Are there any images? And are they sacredly revered? Maybe they will say, oh, we're not worshiping them or praying to them, but in essence, this is what's done. This is how they're revered. So if you take out the second one, then you got to move everything up. So the third becomes the second one in the catechism. And the fourth becomes, and they change it instead of the Sabbath, it says, remember the Lord's Day, because of course to them the Lord's Day is Sunday. And then honor your father and mother, and you shall not kill. We're going to go off the screen. There it is, Sabbath versus Lord's Day. But honor your father and mother had to move up to number four, and you shall not murder moves up to number six, and you shall not commit adultery becomes number six here. I'm sorry, six went to five, and so forth. And you see how these go. But then you have a problem, because number 10 becomes number nine, but now you're out of commandments, and you don't have 10, and you know there's supposed to be 10. So what do? Well, just split that covet one in half. Number 10 has to do with coveting everything in God's law. But in the catechism, they divide it. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife is number 9. And then number 10 is everything else. Don't covet your neighbor's goods, house, servant, everything else. So that's changing God's law in their teachings. Who has the mark of the beast today? Revelation 13:6 says he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads. Nobody has it yet. It's something to come in the future, because we haven't come to a place where we're forced to do this in order to buy or sell. So it's, no one has it. What are the characteristics of those who avoid the mark of the beast? Revelation 14:12 says, here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. So there are a group of people identified in Revelation who at the end of time will be keeping God's commandments and have the faith of Jesus. Again, I'm not here to twist any arms or to tell you how you should believe. As I said all week long, I'm here to do what? Study Scripture together with you. Let the Bible interpret itself. If you agree with me, that's great. We'll be happy. If you don't, I'm going to kick you. No. I won't kick you out. I said, please keep coming, stay with me, and we'll see what else we might agree on. But my understanding of this is, when Revelation says there's a group of people at the end of time who keep God's commandments, that includes the fourth commandment, right? That God expects his people to remember him as the creator and the one that sanctifies and makes us holy, just like he sanctified that time. We spend time with him during that holy time and worship him and honor him by remembering the Sabbath. By the way, when the Sabbath commandment is given in Exodus to Moses, it's remembering him as creator, right? When it's given again at the end of the 40 years before they enter into the promised land, you read it again, and what's the emphasis then? It's not referring back to creation so much in the second giving of the law. It's referring to what? I redeemed you out of Egypt. So both are important, and we remember both when we worship God on the Sabbath. He's our creator, and our Redeemer who saved us out of, in their case, slavery, literal slavery, but for us, slavery from sin. Yes. So the gradual, you see, way back with Eusebius, he was in the 4th century AD, I believe. So it happened long. Were you here when I did the presentation on Sabbath? Last Sabbath. Okay, so were you here? I think it was Sabbath morning last time when I presented, and we saw that there was a law made by Constantine in 325 AD. He was not a church leader, ecclesiastical leader, but he was a political leader who made a Sunday law for the Roman Empire, and things were leading up to it before that, and so it's a gradual, things don't happen overnight. For instance, in our world, we could compare it to this. When I was a child, it would have been really preposterous for anybody to suggest that any church would ordain an openly gay pastor or priest, right? For me, anyway, when I was a child, I never would have thought that would happen. Today, one denomination after another has crossed that line and said, well, you know, we've got to get with the times, whatever. And others have said, no, we don't think that's biblical. Methodist Church, my cousin is Methodist, and he calls me and says, what's going on? You know, what do you guys think about this? And his church has split, and they voted, we are not going along with the main body of the Methodist Church. We're breaking away because we don't agree with this. So this is the kind of thing that has happened gradually over time where some churches accept it, some don't. Same thing happened with the Sabbath. And there have always been people, like I mentioned, the Waldensian believers in the northern Italian Alps. They always held on to Sabbath and were constantly worshiping, writing scriptures by hand, sharing them when they had opportunity. But eventually the Roman, the papal army came and just wiped them out, destroyed them, came up into the mountains. After years of hiding and being able to flee, they finally eradicated, destroyed. Well, either they made them subject or they killed them. So it was gradual that this happened. What relationship does Jesus have with those who receive the seal of God? Revelation 14:4. These are the ones who follow the Lamb wherever he goes. That's how we should be now, right? Just follow Jesus wherever he goes. Stay with the Lord. Let him lead you. Let him be your guide. He's the good shepherd. If I want to be safe, I stay with the good shepherd. I follow him. Follow his example. Follow his teachings. Do everything according to his will. So 3 points to remember tonight, and I apologize for going over. Nobody has thrown anything at me yet, so thank you for that. There is a great time of trouble coming. Daniel said like no one's ever seen before, like there has never been. Serious times ahead. But we're not fearful because we know God's in control. Sometimes you can just say, I want to stand on my tiptoes in anxiety and wait. Lord, what are you going to do? It's going to be exciting. Yes, it's going to be hard, but we will not be alone. And it's in hard times that you do your most amazing miracles. Can I recommend some books for you guys to read, by the way, to encourage your faith for hard times? Read a book called A Thousand Shall Fall. Oh, my goodness. My wife and I, we're driving to Georgia to visit her family, Tennessee, visit our kids, visit her family. And, you know, when I get sleepy, can I confess? Somebody may think I'm a terrible sinner. I listen to the 70s music I grew up with because it just kind of keeps me awake, right? I'm listening to, you know, James Taylor and stuff. I got to see him in concert once. And so, I listen to that music. But it only goes so far. And drinking iced tea has a little caffeine. I don't want to drink coffee because that makes me crazy. But I'm like, I don't want to crash. What do I do, you know? I said, honey, I need a good book to engage my mind and keep me awake. And we'd had this in print for so long, and friends have read it and recommended it. And I said, I wonder if it's on Audible. And I found it on Audible, and I listened. And wow, kept me awake. Exciting book. Gerhardt, the little boy in the book, they called Gerhardt. His name was Gerhardt. He was the dean of the seminary when I went to seminary, Gerhardt Hassel. And It's about the Hazel family. His father was fought in World War I for Germany and then was drafted back into the military in World War II. But by then, he had become a Seventh-day Adventist Sabbath-keeping Christian. You know how hard it is to keep Sabbath in the military and to be a conscientious objector as he was? Wow. The stories of how God took care of him out in the war and his family back home when they wouldn't sign up as Nazis, and so they didn't get the special privileges and the extra food rations that the Nazis got and so forth. Amazing. So after finishing that book, I said, wow, that just gives me so much courage and faith to face the future, to know that God does amazing miracles for his people when we're faithful to him. Another one I recommend is Dare to Stand Alone by Daniel, I forget his last name, but he was a young man, baptized Seventh-day Adventist in the USSR, Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, and he was drafted into the military, and he said, what am I going to do? So from day, he said, if I'm going to do this, I got to start at the beginning. The first Sabbath, he got up on a box, like a platform in the middle of the barracks, and he began preaching. Sabbath morning, a Jeep came flying up, tore up the soil around him and braked, and officers jumped out and they thought they took him away, and he thought, they're going to kill me. Miracle after miracle. I won't spoil the book for you. Read that book, Dare to Stand Alone. It's amazing what God did for him to see him through. So let's not fear that great time of trouble. Let's be expectant that God is going to do amazing things for his people. Even if we're imprisoned. Peter and Paul went to prison too, but God was with them. John went to prison. Right? They boiled John in oil to kill him, and he didn't die. God still had to work for him. He got put on Patmos, said, well, we can't kill him, let's isolate him. And God met him out there in the island of Patmos and gave us the book of Revelation. Amazing things coming. Number two, Satan will seek to deceive the entire world. This is going to be a global problem. And now we are a global society, aren't we? It's sad because we're seeing the loss of culture. Language, clothing, and food are some of the most important key elements of culture. And I love experiencing different cultures, you know? I love lumpia and pancit to my Filipino friends here. I love culture, language, clothing that's different. And today we're becoming a global westernized culture where everything is McDonald's and Coca-Cola and jeans and t-shirts and English. And we are a global community now, and this will be a global problem. Number three, God will seal his faithful saints. They will not receive the mark of the beast. Important to know. Not everybody has to do it. People can say no. And you, by God's grace, and we can be some of those who say, I choose to be faithful to God. I want to be a part of that group that keep his commandments and have the faith of Jesus in the end time. That's the group that's pointed out as the ones who don't receive the mark of the beast, but they have the seal of God. Bible prophecy portrays a time before Jesus returns wherein most of the world will be deceived or coerced into a false system of worship. But it also reveals that God will have faithful people who keep his commandments and have the faith of Jesus. Will you commit now to being one of God's faithful saints? Father in heaven, help us to be so in love with you, so enamored with your beautiful character, that we could never think of doing anything against you. And help us, like Peter and John said in the book of Acts, to say, we ought to obey God rather than men. Let us follow the Lamb wherever he goes now, so that one day we'll be with him forever in eternity. Bless each precious soul here in this gathering tonight, each one of us. We need you. We need your grace in our lives. We need your blessings. We need strength and courage because we live in such challenging times. But help us to live as your children, follow light even in this dark world. We pray in Jesus' beautiful and wonderful name. Amen. So, U.S. in Bible prophecy tomorrow. We're going to see I'll give you a hint. You know, we talked about two beasts tonight. The second beast wants to give authority to the first beast. That's just a little hint of what might be coming when we talk about the U.S. in Bible prophecy, right? Okay. Thank you all. Class is dismissed. God bless you. You don't have to leave.